Oh my gosh, to actually stay solid.
Because it's a magma ocean.
Exactly. So it is the first ocean planet discovered because it has no surface, just an ocean of magma on one side.
Have you ever wondered what it's like to discover a brand new world? In the last 3 decades, we've found over 5,000 planets outside our solar system, called exoplanets. I'm Dr. Jessie Christensen, the lead scientist at the NASA Exoplanet Archive. This is Explore Exoplanets, The Discoverers, a series where I interview the brilliant minds behind the discovery of brand new planets. Hello, everyone. If you're watching this on YouTube, you can also listen to it as a podcast. Head to Apple Podcasts or Google Play and take us with you on your morning commute. If you're listening to us, you can also watch us on YouTube, where you'll find some bonus graphics to help explain what my guest and I are talking about. Speaking of which, welcome. We're joined this morning by Dr. Ben Montet, who is a Scientia Senior Lecturer at UNSW. Hi, Ben.
Hello. How are you doing?
I'm good. It's so good to have you on the show. So let's start with, where are you physically right now?
Yeah, so I'm in Sydney, Australia, on campus of the University of New South Wales, just a few minutes away from the Opera House.
When I've introduced Ben in the past, one of the things we've worked out is that he and I have actually switched places. So I did my PhD at the University of New South Wales, and now I'm at Caltech. And Ben was a student at Caltech and is now a lecturer at the University of New South Wales. He was just telling me
about his
swim at
the beach. We keep not overlapping
your places. Yes, I miss the beach so much. The science is good too, but the beach is really what
needed. Yeah, hard to look past. It's a real selling point.
So how did you get to UNSW? Tell us a little bit about your career path.
Yeah, I took an airplane. It was a really long flight. So I grew up in Chicago and did my undergrad at the University of Illinois. I didn't start with any intention of becoming an astronomer. I started in engineering, but I realized pretty quickly that wasn't for me. And took courses in things I was interested in and really enjoyed my physics class. Mm-hmm. And so I thought, not understanding the implications at all of what this means, like, oh, physicist, that's a job. I could do that. Sure. Why not?
Just fall straight into a physics career, as you do.
Exactly. Yeah. And so I transferred into physics. And when I did, I got an email from one of the administrators in the department. Just, you're real nice. Welcome to the school. So by the way, Professor Gammy is a researcher in the department. He's looking for undergrads to work with him this summer. He studies black holes and pays for a grant.
Oh, okay. Yes, all of those are good
things. I knew I wanted to be on campus that summer, and I thought I'd have one of these stereotypical college delivering pizza type jobs. Mm-hmm. It's like, well, this sounds way better than that. So I applied and got it, mm-hmm. and had a great time. Really enjoyed the project and getting to do astronomy research and be a part of this group.
Did you actually feel like you did real research as an undergrad on black holes? I'm genuinely curious.
Yeah, absolutely. So it was a theory group. They do mm-hmm. simulations. And so we were looking at kind of MHD models of how the accretion disk revolves around a black hole. It was mm-hmm. a tiny little project.
So
never got published or anything.
Magnetohydrodynamics for the audience at home, MHD.
Good. Yeah. So it's magnetohydrodynamics, the way that the magnetic field influences all the fluids, meaning the gas and plasma in the disk around the black hole mm-hmm. and how that changes over time.
Right.
And so it was a super fun project. I learned a lot. I had no programming experience coming in.
And you went straight into a simulation project. Wow.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. But I loved it. And I figured, you know, as long as this is fun, I'm going to keep doing this. And it's been fun since. So mm-hmm. at the end of undergrad, I applied to PhD programs. I was lucky enough to get admitted to Caltech, went there, started mm-hmm. working on exoplanets, and have done that ever since. There's a postdoc at University of Chicago. Mm-hmm. So back home for 3 years. And at the end of that, I had a job offer down in Australia.
Yay.
Why not? Yeah, seems like an adventure. And I've been here 5 years now.
5 years. Oh, gosh. So since before
Unbelievable,
the pandemic,
right?
Actually, right?
Yeah. 3 real years. And then 2020 and 2021.
Right. Yeah. The pandemic time has messed everything up.
Yeah.
So you did get into exoplanets as a grad student. Did you ever think, you know, when you were stumbling into physics as a career and thinking about black holes, did you ever think that you would find a planet around another star?
Never considered it. I was sure when I was applying to grad schools, I was sure of what I was going to work on, and it wasn't exoplanets. I was going to do radio transients. Got to grad school, and there's the opportunity to do kind of a first year project in exoplanets. And I thought, well, I don't think I want to do that for a career, but it could be a good, like, get my feet wet and kind of understand the department, figure out what I'm really going to do for my thesis. And I enjoyed it so much. There were lovely people. I went to a few conferences, met other PhD students around the same age as me, and thought, you know, these are the people that I really want to be working with for the next 30 years. I'm having a great time.
All right. So it was almost more the community than the actual subject matter.
Yeah, the subject matter is great. I love it. But yeah, certainly, you know, the people and getting to go work with these people and work in interesting problems, big part of the sell.
That's very cool. Yeah. Okay, so you didn't think you were going to, but then you start a first year project. Tell us about how you discovered your first planet.
Yeah, so it was a project looking, so Caltech is a partner in the Keck Observatory. Which is a pair of 10-meter telescopes on the Big Island of Hawaii. We were doing long-term observations of thousands of stars as part of the California Planet Search. The group that I was in, several other groups, I'll collaborate on this. They had, you know, for some stars, 20 years of data.
And this is radial velocity data?
Yes, this is radial velocity looking for, measuring the position of a star and how it's moving towards or away from us. Over time,
waiting for the wobble of the star as the planet's
going around. Waiting to see the star have a planet. And so if the star has a planet on a relatively short period, like Earth, you know, 1 year, even, you know, Mars, Jupiter, up to 10 years, over 10 years, you see the star go move away from you, accelerate back towards you, you see this full cycle.
Right.
But if you have a star and a planet in a wider orbit, then you're just going to see a piece of that. You might see a long-term trend, the star is accelerating away from you, but you don't see the full orbits. And so we were looking at systems with long-term trends and then doing direct imaging
to try to... you know that the planet is far away from the star because it has such a long orbit because of this long trend.
Exactly. You know something is there. It could be a planet, could be a star in a much wider orbit, but there's something there not near the star, potentially imageable.
Right.
And so if we can image... do a direct image, get really, really high contrast, separate out the light from the star from everything around it, then any nearby stars you can see, maybe you can find a planet. We didn't actually find any planets directly, but we were able to use this data to rule out there are no stars around here. If there's a star that caused this trend, we would have seen it. If there's a brown dwarf, we would have seen it. And so everything that's left must be a planet.
Okay. All right. And so that sounds cool, but we haven't found any planets yet.
We haven't found any planets yet. Along the way then, as we're looking for these, we're continuing to get more data. And so some of these long-term trends start turning over. And all of a sudden, the thing that's an acceleration is a deceleration. And now you've mapped out a really precise orbit on the system.
All right, so now you don't have a lower period and an upper period. You have the period.
You just have a period, yes. So my first planet then was out of this survey where we said, this system is actually, you know, we've seen that at the turnover, we've seen curvature, we can map out the orbit really precisely. The project was all about trying to find planets around M dwarfs, around low mass stars, red dwarfs.
So tell us about this planet. What's it called?
Yeah, so it's called GJ849C. C meaning it's the second planet in the system. There was one previously known. It's about a Jupiter mass. This is a radial velocity, so it's a minimum mass, right? We measure M sine I because we don't know the inclination, and so we don't know if it's, you know, tugging on the star just a little bit in a face-on orbit. But it's, you know, about a Jupiter mass. It's about Jupiter's distance to kind of 5 AU, not too far from the Earth or Sun-Jupiter system, but around a much smaller star. The star is less than half the mass and radius of the Earth, of the Sun.
Yeah, it's really interesting to think about a true Jupiter analog, but around a very different kind of star.
Yeah, absolutely. But that was the first one I found.
That was the first one. Okay, yeah, so you're gathering this data. It's taking a long time. It finally turns over. How did you feel when you first realized, like, you actually looked at it, the orbit closed, you had a minimum mass? How did you feel when you realized it was a planet?
Oh, it was so cool. Just the idea that you're looking at this and there's the moment of, oh, no one else in the world knows this planet is here. I'm the only person that, I better tell people, but
that makes me wonder how many planets people know about that haven't told people. They're just sitting on hard drives somewhere.
Yeah. that scientific discovery space of, I'm discovering this, like, we're actually creating new knowledge is such a cool feeling. It was, incredible.
The thrill of discovery is really what keeps me in the game. It's really
it doesn't
exciting.
Go away. Every new planet is the same feeling.
Yeah. Speaking of which, how many have you found in total, Dr. Montet?
Yeah, we found about 20 planets that I have led.
So what's your favorite real planet? Is it one of the 20 that you've discovered, or is it another planet?
Well, there's so many great planets. There's so many that are interesting in ways that are, 13 out of 10. They're all great planets in ways that are so different from the solar system, right? We don't have any, or very, very few systems that look like the Earth in meaningful ways. And it's always just so wild to see the things that we never really conceptualized. It is hard to look past Earth. It's a great planet. All my friends are here. So that's my real favorite planet. And it's a reminder as we find all these.
I love it.
Absolutely. But it's also a reminder that as we find all these other planets, just how unique, how special the Earth is, that we could not live on any other planet we've discovered, probably.
Yes.
And we've got this beautiful little thing here.
Right.
If we rule out the solar system in terms of other planets.
Yes, I should have said exoplanet. What's your favorite real exoplanet?
My favorite exoplanet, I really like Kepler-10.
This is
one of the early Kepler discoveries. Mm-hmm. One of our colleagues, Natalie Battaglia, really likes describing it as the first ocean planet that was discovered.
Right.
Because it's in a very, very short period around its star. It goes around every day or so.
Yeah, less than a day.
And so it's blasted by light from the star. And so it's super, super hot, and it melts the crust of the planet.
Right. It's a rocky planet. It's a small rocky planet, yeah.
It's a rocky planet with just a magma ocean because it's continuously destroying the surface. The silicates on the surface of the planet are too hot
to actually stay solid. So it's an ocean planet because it's a magma ocean?
Exactly. So it is the first ocean planet discovered because it has no surface, just an ocean of magma on one side. Yeah.
That's great.
But it's such a wild, who would have ever expected that kind of planet to exist?
It's pretty bananas.
It's amazing. And that was one of the planets that was discovered right as I was starting my PhD, right at the beginning of grad school. Mm-hmm. And just really early Kepler opening our eyes to all of these weird, just how much diversity there is in planetary systems. How many of these systems do not look anything like our solar system?
Yeah, really
and
not much
we
at
continue
all.
To be surprised. Yeah.
Okay. So real planet, real exoplanet. Last question. What's your favorite fictional planet?
Oh, gotta go Vulcan from Star Trek. It's a cool planet. I love the whole mythology of the Star Trek side of things.
Mm-hmm. We're gonna get more into why you like it in the next segment.
Great. For people who are not familiar with Star Trek, it's the planet from Spock's home planet.
Yes, it is where the Vulcans are from. It is Spock's home planet. All right. Thank you, Ben. All right, everybody, thank you so much for listening to this episode. Please follow us on Instagram, Facebook, and X. And wherever you're enjoying this, please like and subscribe or rate and leave a review. And join us next episode. Ben is very excited to tell us all about Vulcan, his favorite fictional planet. And I'm going to tell you about its real-world counterpart, which is kind of a rollercoaster of a story. Thanks, everyone.